mantle is a little bit scary. Emerging tipping points in Antarctica. Nerilie uses paleoclimate records to study how Earth's climate has behaved in the past to provide a long-term perspective on recent climate change. She has a particular focus on reconstructing climate variability in the tropical Indian Ocean and Antarctica, and how this impacts Australia's rainfall patterns. Her work also involves proxy model comparisons to assess forcing mechanisms behind natural and anthropogenic climate changes and helping to test climate model performance in historical and last millennium experiments. Professor Abraham holds an ARC Future Fellowship. In 2015, she received the Dorothy Hill Award from the Australian Academy of Science for her research achievements. She was coordinating lead author of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change Special Report in the Ocean and Cryosphere in a Changing Climate, released in September 2019. She's also a CI in CLEX, and really looking forward to hearing your talk today, Nerilie.
Thanks very much, Craig, for the introduction. I think my bio might be a little bit out of date. So it's been a little while since I've been a future fellow, but anyway, that's my bad. So I'm joining you today from Ngunnawal and Ngambri country in the ACT. So thanks for joining us today, and thanks everybody for joining with this rescheduled seminar. I'll try hopefully not to cough too much during the seminar, thanks for sticking with the rescheduling. So what I'm going to talk about today is a mixture between some work that is underway at the moment, looking at evidence for emerging tipping points in Antarctica. So that work is still very much in progress. So I'll just present a bit of a summary as to where we're at with that work. And then I'm also going to then segue into talking about the Denman Terrestrial Campaign, which was the big field campaign that I was part of in Antarctica over the summer. There's not a lot of scientific data available yet from the material that we collected there, so that section's mostly going to involve showing a few fun little videos about what we actually got up to. So in terms of, I'll just get the slides to progress. So the work that we're doing on emerging tipping points, there's a large number of authors involved in this. I've just listed here the co-authors who are helping to coordinate the different sections of that work, but there's a much larger group of co-authors sort of underneath that as well. So a tipping point. So the definition of a tipping point based on the IPCC glossary is that a tipping point is a critical threshold beyond which a system reorganizes, often abruptly and or irreversibly. So this is one of the most recent sort of summaries of global tipping points. And one of the things that to me really stands out on this is that there are a lot of tipping points that are known to exist in the Northern Hemisphere. But when we come down into the Southern Hemisphere, there's not so many sort of dots on that map. And that doesn't mean that it's been assessed that there aren't tipping points that are relevant to the Southern Hemisphere and Antarctica and the Southern Ocean, but it reflects that to date there hasn't been enough evidence to assess the likelihood of tipping points existing in those systems, with a few exceptions, particularly related to the West Antarctic ice sheet. So I'm going to start by talking about sea ice, and sea ice in 2023 was really one of the big motivators that started this project through discussions that were had at a number of meetings of the different Antarctic centres in Australia last year. So if we think about sea ice, so this is a figure from the most recent IPCC report for Working Group 1, showing what's been happening with sea ice in the Arctic. And so in the Arctic, sea ice has declined in all months. And the projections for the future are that by 2050, it's expected that we will have experienced at least one ice-free summer in the Arctic in terms of sea ice. When we go to the Southern Hemisphere and to Antarctica, There's actually very low confidence in terms of future decreases in Antarctic sea ice. So climate models simulate that there'll be a future decrease in sea ice around Antarctica. But the agreement between observations and models over the historical period isn't very good. And so that gives very limited confidence about our projections of future Antarctic sea ice change. So that was the state of the scientific evidence at the time that the Working Group 1 report was released. But then in 2023, it was fair to describe that as a very remarkable year in terms of Antarctic sea ice. There are other bits of work that have, and particularly sort of media descriptions from scientists, also describing 2023 and the sea ice anomalies that we saw in that year as gobsmacking, mind-blowing, and bonkers. And so what this graph is showing in the grey lines is the annual cycle of sea ice extent around Antarctica for all of the years where we have satellite observations from 1978 to 2022. And then blue is what we saw in 2023. So particularly sort of in the sort of the winter sort of half of the year, seeing that those sea ice anomalies were just well below anything that had been experienced in that historical record before. This is another way of looking at that data, showing the sea ice extent anomalies over time, and the lower panel showing an expression of sea ice edge as a latitudinal anomaly through time. And so what you can see in this historical record is that up until about 2015, there was a very sort of gradual increase in Antarctic sea ice. And this was one of the factors that where the observations in Antarctic sea ice didn't agree with what climate models were simulating. But since that time, there's been a very dramatic decline in Antarctic sea ice. And then in 2023, July of 2023, we saw those anomalies, if you were to quantify how extreme they were relative to the 1981 to 2010 climatology, around July 2023, they fell below a 7 sigma anomaly. So something that was really very extreme. And so that's led to a number of studies suggesting that a regime shift in Antarctic sea ice is underway. Here's a few of those studies, particularly coming out of Australia, looking at that evidence for a regime shift. So a regime shift, to go back to definitions, can also be referred to as a critical transition. It's where there's an abrupt or persistent shift in the current state of a system from one stable state to another. And so a regime shift can describe the change that's associated with a tipping point, but it doesn't describe the tipping point itself. So we have this very dramatic decline in Antarctic sea ice. Based on the historical observations, there's a number of lines of evidence that point towards this being a regime shift. But all of those assessments then ask the question as to whether the observational record of Antarctic sea ice is actually sufficient to characterize the natural variability of Antarctic sea ice. So, for example, that statistic of July of 2023 being a 7 standard deviation anomaly, is that just because of what we see in the observational record, or do we actually does that conclusion hold up if we look over a much longer time period? So that's the first thing that we've done in this study, is to go and bring in the evidence that we have from prior to this observational record. So this is one of the reconstructions that we have for Antarctic sea ice. So in orange, this is a reconstruction that's based on historical observations of pressure, temperature, and climate mode indices, and then used to produce a seasonal reconstruction of sea ice around Antarctica. And if we compare that reconstruction and then put it in the context, then in purple, of the observations, we can see that the winter season of 2023 exceeded a -6 standard deviation event. And across that reconstruction, which goes back more than 100 years, there's no previous sea ice anomalies that ever exceeded -3 standard deviations. We can also look at the variability over time in these records. And in particular, an increase in variability is one of the statistical indicators of an abrupt climate transition. And so we see that increase in the variability of Antarctic sea ice in the observations. And we see that we don't have any other times in this reconstruction where we see a similar increase in variability. So again, the paleoclimate evidence, or the historical evidence in this case, suggesting that the recent changes are in fact very remarkable compared to natural variability. So that was one reconstruction. This is another reconstruction. Importantly, to note here that this is a fully independent reconstruction. So this is a reconstruction that is based on paleoclimate proxy records, and then it uses those proxy records alongside climate models to do a data assimilation to reconstruct sea ice. So all of the inputs and the methods for this reconstruction are different to what was used in that earlier reconstruction that I showed based on historical observations. But if you use this reconstruction, which goes back over 300 years at annual resolution, you produce the same conclusions that the magnitude of sea ice anomalies in 2023 far exceeds anything that could have been expected from natural variability. And the increase in variability, the observed variability of Antarctic sea ice, is also unusual and something that's not seen in the 300 years of the reconstruction. And then there are other ways that we can reconstruct Antarctic sea ice from individual historical records or ice core records and construct reconstructions for particular sectors around Antarctica. And so these reconstructions are based on sort of going and looking at the actual processes as to how an individual proxy record relates to sea ice and the mechanisms and the processes that generate that relationship and building reconstructions that way. And so if we look at the reconstructions that are available from around Antarctica, again, we see that there's a much longer term evidence that Antarctic sea ice in general experienced a decline over the 20th century. With the exception of the Ferrigno ice core, which reconstructs the sea ice in the Ross Sea sector. And the Ross Sea sector, importantly, is the sector of Antarctica that up until 2014 had been showing increased sea ice extent and was one of the reasons why overall Antarctica was showing an increase in sea ice extent in the historical record. And if we go and have a little bit more of a look at that Ferrigno ice core and the South Orkney fast ice record, this historical record, that also gives us evidence for a changing relationship in the regional variability of Antarctic sea ice. So if we look at the 20th century across the reconstruction, there's a negative correlation between the reconstruction that we get from South Orkney and the reconstruction from Ferrigno, so between the Weddell Sea and the Ross Sea. And that's a negative correlation that we see on annual levels, but also in terms of the trends in those data. And then we can also do the same if we look at the observational records and we look at the 20th century component of the observational sea ice extent. Between the Weddell Sea and the Ross Sea, we see a negative correlation. If we do that, again, looking at the 21st century, we see that relationship has shifted to a positive correlation. This evidence that the recent changes that we're seeing in Antarctic sea ice are very different to the natural variability of sea ice around Antarctica. So the other thing that we've been doing in terms of looking at sea ice is to do a comparison of what are we seeing in terms of changes in Antarctic sea ice compared to Arctic sea ice, where there's been a lot stronger evidence for there being a long-term decline in Arctic sea ice, and for that having important climate implications, including the amplification of climate warming over the Arctic. So if we look at the annual sea ice maximum, so in Antarctica, that's in September, in the Arctic, that's March, What we can see is that the long-term trend for the Arctic over the full 45 years of record is much more gradual than the trend that we've seen in Antarctic sea ice over the last decade. So we are comparing different time periods, but just to demonstrate that the rate of change in Antarctic sea ice over that past decade has been very fast compared to the rate of loss of sea ice that we're seeing in the Arctic. And so the magnitude of the decline over the last 10 years in the Antarctic is roughly equivalent to the magnitude of Arctic loss across 45 years. If we go to the sea ice minimum, so in the Arctic, that's September, in the Antarctic, that's February. And we have this IPCC assessment of that the Arctic Ocean will likely be practically sea ice free in September at least once before 2050. And sea ice free is defined as a sea ice extent that's less than 1 million square kilometres. And that, so you can see that grey shading down the bottom indicating that. And so just as a comparison and not evaluating sort of whether this is likely or not, but if the trend that we're seeing in Antarctic sea ice over the last decade were to continue at the same rate, and the Arctic sea ice decline was to continue at the same rate, then it is possible that Antarctica could experience ice-free summer conditions sooner than the Arctic, just as an extrapolation of those linear trends. And finally, just to think about the potential climate amplification of the sea ice changes that we're seeing in the Arctic relative to the Antarctic. And in the Arctic, that long-term decline has been measured to be changing albedo and is one of the factors that's been attributed to the amplification of climate warming over the Arctic. And so the effect of that change in albedo will depend on how much sea ice that you've lost, but also the season that you've lost it, depending on sort of the insulation that is being received in that season. And so calculating that out for the Arctic and the Antarctic, just as a theoretical exercise that doesn't take into account any potential other factors like changes in clouds or seasonal variations in the albedo of sea ice, but just as a theoretical example, what we can see is that the loss of Antarctic sea ice over that past decade has exceeded the potential theoretical climate amplification effect of the Arctic decline. And so the potential implications of what we're seeing going on in the Antarctic are quite significant compared to those amplification effects that we know have been affecting the Arctic climate. Right. So I think that what the analysis has been showing is that when we bring in these longer term bits of evidence, we have strong reasons to think that the recent changes that we're seeing in Antarctic sea ice are exceptional, and that adds weight to the assessments of the observational data saying that a regime shift is underway for Antarctic sea ice. And those sea ice changes do rival what has been seen in the Arctic over a much longer time period. And so we do have concerns about what implications that would have for Antarctic and Southern Hemisphere climate. And one of the areas where this is important is for the formation of bottom water around Antarctica, because the growth of sea ice is one of the important processes that helps to generate the cold and salty water that is important for generating bottom water. So if we think about the overturning circulation of the ocean, and we go back to this assessment of global tipping points, the collapse of the AMOC is one of the better known climate tipping points. It's you can see it on this diagram here. It's the basis of the Day After Tomorrow kind of dramatized movie. Sorry. But again, when we look to this map, we don't see anything indicated on this map for the role that Antarctic bottom water might play in terms of tipping points in the future. And again, that comes down to there not being evidence to be able to make that assessment. So the IPCC assessment for Atlantic meridional overturning circulation is that there will very likely be a decline in the AMOC over the 21st century. If we go to the Southern Ocean, there's limited confidence in changes in Southern Ocean circulation because the processes that are known to be important aren't fully represented in climate models. And this diagram here is one from a paper by Ariane Purich, just comparing the observed bottom temperature in observations and the bottom temperature that's produced in climate CMIP-6 resolution climate models. And so you can see they don't, those models don't produce the very cold observed bottom temperature where you're having formation of the bottom water around Antarctica. And where they do have deep water forming, it's forming in the wrong places for the wrong reasons. So this is something that work through the customer community has been able to start to address. And that the high resolution model that they've generated has unprecedented skill around the Antarctic margin, is able to capture the formation of dense shelf water at the known formation sites around Antarctica. Many of you have probably seen this movie before, but I'll just show that. So this is just showing those sites around the margin of Antarctica that are really important for the formation of this very dense water that then cascades down and flows out to form the bottom water that is distributed then across the global ocean. So work that came out of Matt England's group last year was able to show that if you use this high resolution model that is able to capture the formation processes around coastal Antarctica where bottom water is formed, and that you force them with realistic parameters out to 2050, these simulations produce around about a 40% decline in Antarctic bottom water formation out to 2050. And that looking at the different factors that those models were forced with, so they're forced with climate warming, they're forced with the expected change in surface winds, and then these simulations are also forced with the expected meltwater input that will be coming to the surface ocean because of loss of ice from the Antarctic ice sheet. And it's particularly the addition of that meltwater component that generates this decline in Antarctic bottom water formation. And to do that comparison with how that looks compared to the Atlantic meridional overturning circulation. In these simulations, the Antarctic overturning slows down at double the rate of the AMOC slowdown. And so that's a model result. It's also in the last year been complemented by observational findings. So two studies that both found that there's been an observed 30% reduction in the formation of Antarctic bottom water around Antarctica, both in the wet all sea sector and in the Australian Antarctic basin. So it looks like from the observational data that simulated slowdown of Antarctic bottom water formation is already underway. So that has a whole range of implications for the environment and for the climate. In the Antarctic context, it's quite important for ice sheet stability because of the role of Antarctic bottom water and how that interacts with the amount of warm water that is coming back up onto the shelf, the subsurface warm water. So in terms of ice sheets, Antarctic ice sheets are assessed in as being potential tipping points for future warming. So in particular, the West Antarctic ice sheet is an area that for a long time has been known to be potentially very vulnerable to climate warming. But in the most recent assessments of tipping points, we also see that the East Antarctic subglacial basin starting to be included in those known tipping points as well. So this little animation, which I'm sure many of you will have seen before, excuse me, shows ice loss from around Antarctica and Greenland, measured by the GRACE and the GRACE follow-on missions. And so if we look at the Antarctic diagram here, we can see that orangey red color generating, forming around West Antarctica. So this is where ice is being lost from West Antarctica. But as we continue on in this simulation as well, sorry, not this video as well of observational data, it's what we also see is that we're starting to see these red colours developing around parts of East Antarctica, particularly associated with the Aurora subglacial basin. Okay. And so the reason why West Antarctica and those East Antarctic subglacial basins are thought to be quite vulnerable to climate warming is not because of warming of the atmosphere, but because of the way that the ice shelves and the ice sheet interact with the ocean at the front of the ice sheet. And in particular, where we have warm subsurface water coming up onto the shelf, that provides a really effective mechanism for melting that ice. And because the ice sheet is sat on bed that is below sea level and gets deeper as you move back further into the continent, this can create an unstoppable situation where when you start to destabilize the ice sheet, you then generate a reinforcing set of circumstances where as the ice sheet retreats, it's then even more exposed to warm water that is able to melt it further. So for the West Antarctic ice sheet, where we know that there is concern and that we've known that for a long time, over the last decade or so, there's been a large campaign called the Thwaites Glacier Campaign as an interdisciplinary study to understand the stability of ice in West Antarctica. And this interdisciplinary type study is what's needed to understand all of the aspects that go into determining the risk of loss of ice being lost from ice sheets. So it depends on how the ice is flowing, the structure of the ice shelves, the water being able to get in underneath the ice shelf, and a whole range of other factors as well. And so this is the type of study, this is a program that's been run between the US and the UK to generate the information that's needed to better understand West Antarctica. Unfortunately, the findings coming out from this is that accelerated melting of the West Antarctic ice sheet cannot be avoided this century, even in a low emissions scenario. And a lot of that is to do with the ocean warming that will continue to erode away at the West Antarctic ice sheet. If we go to East Antarctica, this was a study that was published a couple of years ago, what summarizes a study published a couple of years ago, looking at the East Antarctic ice sheet. And so the evidence there is that there are parts of the East Antarctic ice sheet that are potentially vulnerable to climate warming, particularly those subglacial basins. But if warming can be kept to below 2 degrees, then substantial ice loss from the East Antarctic could still be averted. And so this diagram here is just another diagram showing a different estimate for where ice sheet mass loss has occurred since 2003. And then on the right-hand side is the Antarctic bedrock topography. So any areas here in blue, there are areas where the light blue colors, areas where the ice sheet is sat on ground that is below sea level. And so you can see, particularly over in this part of East Antarctica, around the Wilkes subglacial basin and the Aurora subglacial basin, there are large areas where ice is sat with that same subconfiguration as what we see in West Antarctica. And a particular area of concern is the Denman Glacier. So Denman Glacier, you can see, just pointing with the arrow, to this area that's in between some Casey Station and Davis Station. We can see that there's ice being lost from here. But importantly, as improvements have been made to our understanding of the topography of the bedrock beneath Antarctica, the bedrock of Denman Glacier has been found, or potentially found, to be the deepest known point of land on Earth. So the current estimates are that this glacier is sat on ground that is 3.5 kilometers below sea level. So that's a potentially very unstable situation in a warming climate. And the glacier is estimated to hold behind it roughly the equivalent of 1.5 meters of sea level equivalent. So that's a result that's based on airborne geophysical data. It's a result that is has some uncertainty to it because of the difficulties of being able to reconstruct such a steep canyon from its steep and deep canyon from that airborne data. For that reason, and for just because we actually don't know very much about Denman Glacier, that was the rationale between this big campaign that was has been running over the past couple of years, and particularly the science effort that was that took place over this last summer. So now I'm going to segue into the Denman terrestrial campaign. So this is a photograph of the Denman Glacier taken during the summer from one of the helicopter trips that was there, taking people out to different sites to study Denman Glacier. And this was a program run across the different Antarctic Science Centres that we have in Australia. So we've got the Australian Centre for Excellence in Antarctic Science, the Australian Antarctic Program Partnership, Securing Antarctica's Environmental Future, and then the Australian Antarctic Program. What I showed for Thwaites Glacier, understanding the risks to Denman Glacier requires an interdisciplinary approach. So we can't understand, how Denman Glacier might change in the future only by studying sort of one aspect of this glacier. We need to develop a comprehensive understanding of all of the ice, atmosphere, geological factors, ocean factors that all come together to influence how this glacier is going to behave in a warming climate. So some context for where we were. So the red dots show Australia's main Antarctic stations. So these are Macquarie Island in the sub-Antarctic, and then Casey, Davis and Mawson. And then the yellow dot is showing where the location of Bunga Hills, which is sort of beside Denman Glacier. There is a small camp there known as Edgeworth David Camp. So it's not a place where there's personnel stationed all year round or even every summer, but it is a place where there is some infrastructure to be able to launch field campaigns or base field campaigns from there. Rightio. Oh, and one of the things that's worth noting, and I'll come to later, is that at this Bunga Hills camp, the maximum population that we reached out there during the summer was 45. And so at that point, that actually rated Bunga Hills as being the third largest base in the Australian Antarctic program for the summer. So it had a larger population than what was on Macquarie Island or Mawson. So here's an aerial shot. You can see Bunga Hills and then the Edgeworth David camp. Then you have, you can see Denman Glacier flowing out from there. The Shackleton ice shelf off to the side, and all of this located around about 450 kilometres from Casey Station. Here's a shot of me on a day off, did a hike up to a location known as Camel's Hump. And then in the background, you can see the camp. So we've got sort of the camp with these sort of red melons, the larger sort of Weatherhaven tents, which were the kitchen and the living areas, all of these sort of this field of yellow polar domes, which are the individual sleeping tents. And then out on the, sorry, we've got the lake here, which was the freshwater supply for camp. And then down on the ice, this is sea ice on an epishelf lake. And you can just sort of make out maybe a couple of helicopters that are sat out there. And so the camp was supported by two helicopters. And then there was also, for large parts of the season, a twin otter that was based out there as well. And then flights with two Baslers that were helped to move people and equipment between Casey and Bunga Hills. And then all the scientific equipment stored out on the ice, ready to go for being deployed. So this is sort of what sort of camp life looked like sort of at the end of a day after people have come back from doing their various bits of science. Rather than talk more, I'm going to play the first of, I've got three little videos. So this is a video about camp life in Bunga Hills. So that was just a fun little video about camp life. So there are sort of a number of aspects in there. So there's a big science team. There were 27 scientists involved in the program, in the field program over the summer. And then the support personnel included six field training officers who went out to make sure that the scientists stayed alive. There was a field leader, there was a science leader who helped to coordinate the different priorities, make sure that everybody was getting access to be able to do their science. There were two helicopter pilots, two helicopter engineers. When the twin otter was there were two twin otter pilots and a twin otter engineer. There was a doctor, there was a communications officer who coordinated communication between aircraft and Casey, and then between the different teams when they were out in their camping away from Bunga Hills main area. There was a chef, and an AGSO who helped to do all the loading and unloading of planes and coordinating the paperwork around planes coming in and out. Then there was an engineer as well who made sure that the electricity worked, the generators, turned them on at 6 a.m. in the morning and then off again at 8 o'clock at night, made sure the water was available for camp, and all those types of logistics. So it was really quite a tight team. Did I mention there was a doctor as well? There was a doctor out there too. And fortunately, the doctor didn't have very much to do. So at one stage, even came out to help with our ice drilling as well. So in terms of the science that happened, there were a number of teams who were working on different parts of the project that all come together to form the Denman Terrestrial Campaign. So the project that I was leading was the RAID team, so RAID Rapid Access Ice Drilling. And so we started out with a team of four. So this is myself, Sarah Jackson, Maddie Rosevere, and Mick Rofe. So Mick Rofe was the field training officer assigned to our project. And so what our aim was to collect the samples to be able to understand how climate in the Denman Glacier region varies naturally, and if it's changing. And this is a photo taken from Casey where we were doing our survival training prior to heading out into the deep field. So the rapid access ice drill, it's designed to be a fast and lightweight alternative to drilling traditional ice cores, which you might be familiar with. And for just to put a little bit of perspective as to sort of why we would want to be doing rapid access ice drilling rather than traditional drilling. So the Aurora Basin project is a project that the Australian program ran in 2013-2014. You can see a couple of shots of camp here. Camp had, from memory, about 14 people in it, but a huge amount of logistics. You can see just from sort of the number of tents there. And so a huge program that just by itself put quite a bit of strain on the Australian program to be able to pull that off, and also had input from the French, including getting a lot of the equipment there on a French traverse, and the Danish as well, for particularly bringing in part of the drilling equipment to be used in that season. We also had the Mount Brown South project, led by Tessa Vance in 2017-2018. So this was a bit of a smaller project, but still quite logistically tough and hard to pull off for the Australian program. So there was a team of between sort of 7 and 8 out in this camp, 16 tons of equipment that had to be moved out there and then moved back again. And then you can see in that shot of the ice drilling, the amount of logistics that goes to sort of setting it up as well. So you can see we're standing in a pit that's been dug down into the snow with then a weather haven on top before you can then start to assemble all the drilling equipment to be able to work. So the idea of the rapid access drilling is that we can go and drill ice samples in a much shorter window of time, right? We don't need the whole season to do it, and with a lot less equipment. So for this program, we had about 3 tons of equipment, including the people and all the camp equipment as well, to get us out into the field. And so that meant that we could be deployed in a single day and then extracted in a single day as well. And so here's another video showing about how we drilled the ice using this rapid access drill. Thank you. And so I mentioned at the start that we started out with a team of four for raid one, and that was the plan. But for Antarctic fieldwork, the key is always to be adaptable. Because of weather, we were late being able to get out to start the field program. And so various people then had to move on to other projects. And so we ended up with a rotation of quite a few people actually who came up from Bunga Hills to then sort of fill in and make sure that we were able to continue drilling and make that project a success. So we're very grateful for people stepping in to help us out with that. In terms of the science that we achieved, so at the first site, we drilled to a depth of 200 meters and 88 centimeters. We collected more than 5,000 ice samples, and that's estimated that it will give us about 500 years of climate history for the Denman region. As well as doing our primary science, and this was one of the benefits of also having other people coming up from Bunga Hills to help us out, was that we were also able to get a lot of geophysical work done at this site as well, so including an MT installation, a seismic survey, and logging of the temperature of the borehole. We also, after raid one, we did a second drilling with the raid system where we went out to Mill Island. This one, again, had a team that rotated slightly. And as well as the main team, we also were really lucky that other people came out to the site to help us both in setting up the camp to get us all sort of set up. Because we had such a very narrow window of time to work in. So they helped to get us set up in a single day. And then people who also came to help dig us out on the evening before we were being retrieved, including the pilots who were there with shovels in hand, helping to dig out our tents. The reason there was so much digging was that the weather was particularly bad up on Mill Island. So we were on site at that location for 7 days. And of that, 5 days were blizzards. So we had about 36 hours of science, hence why there's also a lot of sunset nighttime pictures, because we in that 36 hours of science were working sort of quite late into the evening to make sure that we could get everything done, or at least a decent amount done before we were being picked up at the end of the season. So that record should span about 20 years. And the idea there was to overlap with the ice core that was drilled in 2009 and 2010. Again, a lot of geophysical work that happened as well at that location. So I'm just going to quickly go through some of the other things. Some of the other things that were done, there was a hot water drilling team known as a hot tub party. They spent a month out on Shackleton Ice Shelf. This was the camp before it got blizzarded in. Their aim was to get through the ocean, which they did. They drilled 203 metres through the ice shelf and then sampled through the 800 metres of water, measuring the composition of the water and also collecting a sediment core from the sediments below. There was a team working on the transect across Denman Glacier. They were helicoptered out each time, so they were aiming to constrain the shape and the motion of Denman Glacier. And also to not fall down a crevasse. So it was quite a tricky site to work at, or a number of sites to work at. And there were people working on rocks and mud. So they basically went to any location where there was bedrock poking out of the around the ice sheet, looking to constrain the history of the ice sheet and sea level in the area, as well as the geology. So one final video just to sort of show a snapshot of the work that everybody was doing. So that was a quick summary of Denman Terrestrial Campaign. It was an absolutely amazing program to be with, and to see the Australian program doing something so ambitious in terms of field science in Antarctica. And just to mention that there will be another season of Denman Terrestrial this season, with a little bit of science and Camp Packup, and hopefully also Denman Marine, which will see Noyina going into the front of the Denman at the early next year. Okay, thanks very much, everyone.
Thanks so much, Nerilie, both for the talk, and also, wow, to you and the whole team who was down there. That's, wow, you really get to see the challenge of doing that. They're very important work. I think I'll just go straight. We don't have much time, so I'll just go straight to the chat. Nathan Bindoff asks, when you work with ice ships like that, maybe he meant the ice drills, what is the temporal ice chips? When you work with ice chips like that, what is the temporal resolution?
So that'll depend on the site. So at Mill Island, where we have sort of 2 meters of snowfall a year, it'll be very high temporal resolution. Up at Raid 1, less so, but probably have about half a meter of snow a year up at that inland site. So in terms of sampling, we were sampling at sort of between sort of 5 to 10 centimeters of resolution in terms of the depth of ice. Potentially a little bit of mixing, but not too much, so that the chips basically, as you drill them, they go up the spiral inside the drill, and then we bring the jewel back up, we reverse it, and the chips come back out in the reverse order that they went in, and then we sample them from that. We did collect some COVAX cores as well, to be able to do that comparison of being able to test exactly sort of what the resolution, the effective resolution is that we can achieve from the chips.
Thanks. Quick one from Pandora Hope. Can your paleo data get resolution that might capture a rapid decline similar to what we've seen in recent years?
A rapid decline in sea ice?
I think she means sea ice.
Certainly those site level records where we've got individual reconstructions of sea ice, it would be it'll be really interesting to see how the proxy data looks at those types of locations in response to this the rapid decline that we've seen in Antarctic sea ice over the last decade. Unfortunately, I don't think we really have the information available to be able to do that yet. There is some work that we can do with Mount Brown, but that was drilled in 2017, so it doesn't take us up to there, but I'm sure that it'll be something that is generated in future years, looking at how that rapid decline is represented in proxy records.
Great, thanks, Nerilie. I think we're going to have to leave it there. So let's thank Nerilie one more time, and I think you now move on to the ECRs, Nerilie. So thanks again, and yeah. I'm sure lots of people have more questions. I know I do, but another time. Okay. Bye.
Thanks very much.
Cheers.